Could light therapy be a treatment for tinnitus? A new study suggests mid-infrared photons may help to rewire the auditory brain and reduce ringing in the ears. In this episode of Sound Science, we'll review a recent study examining the connection between tinnitus and the dysfunction of specific potassium ion channels found in the auditory cortex, a key part of the brain that processes sound. I'm Dr. Ben, and this is Dr. Michelle. We're audiologists at Treble Health. Our doctors of audiology have helped over 2,000 patients with comprehensive tinnitus treatment. So let's jump into today's episode of Sound Science. Tinnitus affects millions worldwide, and it's often caused by abnormal neural activity in a part of the brain referred to as the auditory cortex. There are specific potassium ion channels called KCNQ2, and these are potassium channels that regulate neuron excitability. We know that tinnitus is often linked to the auditory brain, not just the ear. Abnormalities in these potassium channels can contribute to the hyperactivity associated with tinnitus. And it's worth mentioning that potassium is also an essential mineral for the cochlea, the spiral-shaped structure in the inner ear that's responsible for transmitting sound signals to the auditory nerve and eventually the brain. So potassium helps maintain the electrical charge in the cochlea's hair cells, which are critical for hearing. A deficiency in potassium can potentially disrupt that balance, leading to hearing loss. And that potassium is also seen here in the auditory brain.
So what are mid-infrared photons and how are they used? Infrared light actually consists of electromagnetic waves that are invisible to the human eye. The mid-infrared photons have wavelengths between 3 to 8 micrometers, which are able to penetrate deep into tissues much more than visible light. This has been found to be safe in a non-invasive way to already treat different things like wounds and pain management. And it's an external delivery, meaning that it's delivered through devices like lasers or LEDs that are directed at the scalp or external head regions. The way that these mid-infrared photons were used in this study were that they were directing the light at the auditory cortex. The photons then activated the KCNQ2 channels, reducing the hyperactivity in the auditory cortex that was believed to be linked to the tinnitus. From the study itself, the researchers said that the photon-mediated activation of the KCNQ2 channels effectively reduced neuronal hyperexcitability, which is a primary cause of tinnitus. Their results demonstrated that mid-infrared light selectivity, when precisely targeting the auditory cortex, was able to activate the KCNQ2 channels, which offers a novel and non-invasive approach at suppressing tinnitus. It was found to also be able to modulate the auditory cortex activity without any systematic side effects.
So how does this impact you, and what does this mean for tinnitus treatment? Well, our patients are always looking for things they can do to get better results. And we know that tinnitus treatment today uses various tools and techniques that are quite effective, but there's room, there's opportunity for new, complementary, or potentially better treatments. In terms of how this approach could provide relief, essentially it would be stabilizing the auditory brain activity, which is a key driver of tinnitus. So go through this thought experiment with me. If you have a high-pitched hearing loss and you have tinnitus, someone can have a worse hearing loss than you, but they have less tinnitus. Someone can have the same hearing loss as you, but they have more tinnitus. So it's clear that there's something more than just the ear happening with tinnitus. And this study, this potential approach, is targeting the auditory brain, which is not the other part of the ear, the other end, essentially, of the tinnitus situation. The researchers from this study observed a significant suppression of tinnitus-like behaviors in animal models. And one of the most common comments we get with these scientific review studies using animal models is, how could researchers possibly know if an animal, like a rat or a chinchilla, for example, how could researchers possibly know that this animal has tinnitus? And how could you measure tinnitus in an animal? Many patients tell me that they feel like no other doctor has really measured their tinnitus as a human. So how does it work as an animal? Well, researchers measure tinnitus in animals by observing changes in behavior. For example, altered responses to sound or silence. So how it works is, unfortunately, they essentially cause a hearing loss in these rats by playing loud noise. So they create a hearing loss through loud noise, and they can estimate what pitch the animal has tinnitus based on their loud noise exposure and hearing loss. Then the researchers would play similar frequencies, similar pitches of sound continuously, and they would stop the sound. There's something called the startle response, or the acoustic startle, where if you have a consistent sound and you stop it, the nervous system will sort of jump and react, or if there's no sound and you play a sound, the nervous system will jump and react. Well, if that sound is the same pitch as the constant tinnitus the animal has, then the researchers, through the animal's behavior, can predict essentially with some degree of confidence that the animal has tinnitus. That's essentially how it works. So this potential benefit for you who's listening, if you have tinnitus, would be if this approach could address the neural mechanisms behind tinnitus, the auditory brain, then that would potentially be really positive for you. The study mentioned, quote, "This approach not only alleviates tinnitus symptoms, but also provides a framework for developing light-based therapies for other neurological disorders." So further research is certainly needed to test the efficacy of this in human subjects. Well, let's not jump to conclusions about this exciting approach because it hasn't yet been tested in human subjects. Animal models are the first necessary step in order to get to human trials, so this is a good sign. However, this may not work the same way based on different types of tinnitus. This was measured for animals who have noise-induced tinnitus. There are some differences in the neuron activity between different types of tinnitus. Animal models found that only about 50% of those exposed to loud noises experience tinnitus, which is important to highlight to many of our patients who might be afraid that loud noises would create or worsen their tinnitus. It is important to protect your hearing, but just know that not all loud noise exposure will lead to more tinnitus.
So who could this benefit? Patients who have tinnitus that's caused by auditory cortex hyperactivity. Like Dr. Bennett just mentioned, this was only studied on noise-induced tinnitus, so it may not be the same for other types of tinnitus. It may also be helpful for individuals who are looking for non-invasive alternatives to pharmacological or sound-based therapies. If found to be successful in human trials, this therapy could really revolutionize tinnitus care because it could offer precise targeted relief that patients are receiving in clinics. And potentially, if a product is designed that can offer this infrared mid-photon technology from home, it might be an apparatus that patients can utilize in the safety and comfort of their own homes. So as the researchers said, one day patients may experience a simple outpatient procedure involving light application to their auditory cortex that can have extreme benefits to their perception of tinnitus. Additionally, this might open up future research looking at medications that alter the potassium ion channels, because this may also be a key to improving tinnitus.
So what have we learned today? We've learned that mid-infrared photons, which can send certain light signals through the skull, eventually into the auditory brain, could offer an exciting new avenue for tinnitus research by addressing neuron hyperactivity in the auditory cortex. While more research is needed, this is definitely a development to follow. So if you have tinnitus and you're interested in the future of tinnitus treatment, remember to subscribe to the Treble Health YouTube channel right here to stay up to date on the newest tinnitus research. And if you'd like to speak with Dr. Michelle or myself, Dr. Ben, please reach out to us. You can click the link on the screen right now or head over to treblehealth.com for a free telehealth consultation to review your specific case and offer potential solutions. Thanks, guys, and have a great day.